India is a nation with a history and culture that goes back 3,000 years before the birth of Christ. It's a strange land in Southeast Asia where 1.2 billion people live and practice numerous religions. India's 3,200,000 square kilometers shares its borders with Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, China, and Burma. India abounds with natural beauties from the Himalayan plateau, the Ganges and mountainous regions, to plains, forests and deserts with various weather conditions. The national flag of India is a horizontal rectangular tricolour of deep saffron, white and Indian green, with the Ashok Chakra, a 24-spoke wheel in navy blue at its centre. India Gate, Qutb Minar, Humayun Tomb, and Taj Mahal can all be found in the city of Agra, 70 kilometers from Delhi. Indian culture is brimming with elements of Iranian culture and civilization. Every inch of India's vast expanse bears witness to that. In the buildings and structures, in the manuscripts and libraries, and even the streets. For about 800 years, Farsi or Persian was the language used by Indian royals and people in administrative positions.
I'm Hassan Zaidi. I was born in Iran, but my mother and father are Indians who immigrated to Iran. At the moment, I'm a student at university. I study social communication science. For my thesis, I decided to seize the opportunity to do some research about history, civilizations, architecture, and the Persian language. What comes to our aid in our research is not just the literature we find in libraries, but the general atmosphere of the streets, the people's traditions and culture, historical buildings left to us from past generations, and the art forms that this ancient land has to offer in every street and alleyway. It seems the Persian language is what the people of India and Iran have in common. It's what brings them together. The last 800 years show that the Persian language's influence over India has affected many elements of everyday life for its people, giving it a Persian hue.
History tells us that Farsi came to India around 800 years ago, especially to its northern regions, influencing the social dynamics of India as well as its politics, economy and culture, particularly in the earlier of those 8 centuries. Its effect was so profound that from then on most of the country's cultural, religious, political, literary and administrative texts were written in Persian, as were all personal and government documents, including judicial decrees and the like. For centuries, this land fostered and cultivated the Persian language.
Hind-Irani taluqat ki tareekh aaj aur kal ki nahi, balki ye zamanae ma qabl tareekh سے اس کی شروعات ہوتی ہے ہندوستان میں والے ہوں یا ایران والے ہوں یا اس کے بیچ کے لوگ ہوں جو بستے ہیں وہ سب جو ہیں ان کا رشتہ آریائی نسل سے جڑا ہوا ہے ہماری زبان سنسکرت ہو یا پہلوی ہو ہمارے تاریخ ہماری تہذیب ہماری ثقافت سب ایک دوسرے سے گوندھی ہوئی ہیں جنہیں کہتے ہیں اور یہ ہماری مشترکہ تہذیب जो है उसका नतीजा है कि अगर आप देखें तो लिबास में शेरवानी, खाने में बिरयानी, बोलने में उर्दू, और अगर ज़मीन पर आप देखना चाहें तो ताजमहल जैसी अजीम इमारत हो, या लाल किले की पुख्तगी हो, या कुतुब मीनार की बुलंदी हो, या तसव्वुफ़ की रिवायतें हो, इन सब का रिश्ता जाकर ईरान से मिल जाता है। और हिंदुस्तान और ईरान एक दूसरे से इस कदर करीब है जैसे कि हवा के अंदर खुशबू होती है और आँख में काजल होता है। ये दोनों एक दूसरे के हुस्न में इजाफा ही करते हैं, हमारे एहसासात को नई बालीदगी अता करते हैं। ये एक दूसरे से जुदा नहीं बल्कि एक दूसरे से मिले हुए हैं।
You have a very famous quatrain from the famous Iranian poet Muslehuddin Saadi Shirazi. He says, "All mankind are actually part of one body, and if one part aches, the other part also gets affected." And we have got the famous hadith according to Islamic sources also from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, "Kullana min Adam wa Adam min turab." He says, "All of us are from Adam, and Adam is from clay." That means all mankind have got a single root. And if you look into history, this is all the Iranians and the Indians, they're actually very close to each other. Some thousands of years back, maybe some 3,000 years back or more than that, there were migrations, waves of migration from Central Asia of the Aryan race. One branch came and settled in the Iranian plateau, and the other branch came to North India. And they had the same tendencies, they had the same culture, they had the same actual religion and ideology and the same ethnicity. And in course of time, because of the geographical factors, there might have been some separation between them. And there was an independent evolution, those living in the Iranian plateau and those living in North Indian plain. But actually, since the roots of the people of the race were same, there has so many similarities and commonalities.
History has several explanations as to how the Persian language found its way into cultures so far afield. One is the immigration of Iranians to other lands, some of them caused by war and upheaval. Thus it was that Farsi became the language of science, wealth, religion, and power in India. It was during the time of the Indian king Humayun and the Safavid period in Iran that many people emigrated from Iran. Humayun, who ascended to the throne with the help of Iran's Safavid king Tahmaseb, welcomed Iranian scholars, poets, and scientists to India. Among the poets that went to India, some of them ending up in the royal court, were Zahiri Naishaburi, Ghazali Mashhadi, Talib Amoli, Kalim Kashani, and Halim Lahiji. The emigration of Iranian traders, cultural figures, and scientists to India was the most influential element in the spread of Farsi in that country.
India has been a center of Persian studies since the last, say, 700-800 years. And you see, initially it was mystic literature which was brought to India, and that created really a great impact on Indian psychology, where, you know, the poets, the authors, philosophers, all of them, in fact, combined together, got together, putting heads together, and started writing on, Indo-Persian ethos. And therefore, you see, a large number of mystics we find in India, in every nook and corner of India, and they really created a very good atmosphere of learning Persian language and literature.
Kings fond of the Persian language were in power in India. Their support for Iranian scientists and poets helped the language take root in that country, where it soon would become one of the nation's official languages.
There has been quite a lot of influence from Iran to India. There is an, I think, quite up to 1850s, quite last century, Persian was a court language in India. So if you see the, all the archives, the documents which India, they are in Persian language. So the, till the kings and whoever came, they had an Iran lineage. They came from Iran.
Lekin dar haqiqat darbar ki, sarkar ki, adab ki, aur tehzeeb ki, aur siqafat ki alamat jo hai. اور ضرورت جو ہے وہ فارسی زبان ہی سمجھی گئی اسی لیے ہندوستان میں جو غیر مسلم بڑے تعداد میں لوگ تھے انہوں نے بھی فارسی زبان کو اختیار کیا سیکھا اور اس کے اندر اپنے جوہر بھی دکھائے
The effects of the Persian language on Indian culture are very apparent. This can be seen clearly in the country's language, literature, architecture and art forms. There are few cultural or scientific institutes in India that do not display signs of Persian influence in poetry and verse alike. In universities and colleges across India, there are more than 50 Persian language departments hard at work, and more than 100 schools teach Farsi as part of their curriculum. In most traditional and Islamic schools, students study Farsi texts and are familiarized with the works of the great Iranian poets like Sa'di, Hafiz, Ferdowsi and Khayyam.
Some of the Iranian poets have been very popular amongst the Iranians, you see. Take for example, Omar Khayyam. Omar Khayyam has been very popular in India, and we have so many Indian Omar Khayyam as a result of the popularity of Omar Khayyam in India. And what we see that a great scholar and poet of Hindi literature, Harivansh Rai Bachchan, who wrote Madhubala, Madhushala and Madhukalas, you see, they are all, people say, that is a second version of Khayyam's Rubaiyat. Now, apart from Khayyam, Nizami Ganjavi is also very famous, in fact, like, you know, Khamsa Nizami, and Amir Khusro writing another Khamsa. So therefore, Maulana Jalaluddin Rumi, Hafiz, and Sa'di, and Jami, you see, later on, you see, all of them have created their own methods and their own place amongst the hearts and minds of the people of India. For instance, you see, if you go to the southern part of India, you will find a number of Omar Khayyams in Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam languages. Why? Because, you know, the kind of poetry Omar Khayyam rendered in Persian, for instance, in Qafilay Umr Ajab Mi Guzarat, Daryab Dami Kebaud Tarab Mi Guzarat, Saqi Ghami Fardaw Ye Harifan Chikuri, Bichar Piyale Ra Ke Shab Mi Guzarat.
But the manuscripts written in Persian that can be found in libraries across the country bear witness to the spread of Farsi across this great nation down the centuries. There are very few buildings that have not been embellished with Persian calligraphy and very few libraries that do not hold Persian manuscripts. The head of the Persian Language Research Center in New Delhi supports that claim.
ما اگر بخوایم بدونیم که بیشترین نسخه های خطی زبان فارسی الان در کدام کشور با احتساب اینکه خود ایران رو در نظر بگیریم، آسیای میانه رو در نظر بگیریم و ترکیه و کشورهای مختلف، هندوستان بیشترین نسخ خطی فارسی رو در جهان داراست. هنوز مثلا نسخه های سعدی، حافظ، مولوی، خیلی نسخه های دیگه در اینجا نگهداری میشه که خیلی از اینها هم با هنر و نفاست آمیخته است. به عنوان مثال در کتابخانه خدابخش پتنا در ایالت بیهار هندوستان، در اونجا فقط در یک کتابخانه خدابخش 50 نسخه شاهنامه نگهداری میشه که بیش از 10 نسخهش دارای اثر هنری بالا همراه با مینیاتورهای زیباست.
برای زبان فارسی وقتی وارد شد در حکومت‌ها تأثیر گذاشت، در فرهنگ و تمدن اینها تأثیر گذاشت یواش یواش، به خاطر اینکه ایرانی ها صاحب ذوق و سلیقه خاصی بودن، حکومت ها اینها رو پذیرفتن، وارد هند شدن. از زمان غوری ها فارسی در اینجا رواج داشته و کم کم زبان درباری شد، زبان رسمی شد و تمام مکاتبات و اینها به زبان فارسی انجام میگره. و این رو هم نکته چیز هست که ما الان در هند میلیون ها سند فارسی داریم که در آرشیف های مختلف هند نگهداری میشه. از جمله‌اش مثلا آرشیو حیدرآباد هستش که شاید شما ندیده باشید، بیش از 10 میلیون سند فارسی در اونجا هست.
ما تا حالا نسخه های بسیار با ارزشی از دستخط های مثلا بیدل دهلوی، خود اون کتابی که صاحب با خودش از ایران آورد، من اون رو مثلا با چشم خودم دیدم و پیدا کردم جایی در یک کتابخانه در کلکته. اینا هنوز چاپ نشده، در ایران نرفته. گاهی وقتا نسخه هایی هست که سابقه بسیار طولانی داره. ما اخیراً یک کتابی که متعلق به 930 سال پیش بود و حاوی شعرها و حکایات، اون رو پیدا کردیم و سی دی هاشو گرفتیم و برای کتابخانه های مهم ایران فرستادیم. میگم اینجا به هر حال سرزمینی است که پر از آثار مشترک ماست.
A stroll along India's streets and a quick glance at some of its buildings show just how much the Persian language meant to its people, and still does today. Silent slabs of stone and placards tell the tale of Farsi spread across India. The Taj Mahal that belongs to the 16th century has many a Persian inscription. Farsi has been used to inscribe the graves of those who inspired and built the Taj Mahal, portraying the marriage of the two cultures most elegantly. But apart from the Taj Mahal, there is the Humayun tomb, another masterpiece left behind by an Indian royal. The affection Indian royals had for the Persian language is apparent here also. By using Farsi in their architecture, we see how the language was inscribed on their hearts as well.
The major was the architecture, in fact, you see. The Iranian architecture is seen everywhere, you see, with the combination of Indian architecture, you see, like Taj Mahal. Taj Mahal, you see, you cannot really think about any architecture by ignoring Taj Mahal, in fact. And similarly, you see, all the forts, you see, which we find in India, they are testimony to the Iranian architecture. Similarly, you see, the paintings and the calligraphy particularly, you see, if you see the type of calligraphy developed by the Iranians in India with the help of the Indians, you see, and the interaction between the Muslim world and the Hindu world, in fact, you see, so they really, it's a wonderful combination.
Persian dictionaries written in India have helped the proliferation of the Persian language. This in itself shows how dear the Persian language became in that country, and how towards the end of the 15th century, the Indian people cherished Persian words and phrases maybe more than Iranians themselves. 12 Persian dictionaries were compiled in India from the 15th to the 17th century, and the archives of Indian universities and literary institutes are full of Persian texts. Thus it was that with the spread of the Persian language, the Persian or Iranian culture crept into the lives of the Indian people. The bond became so strong that it went beyond the physical aspects of life to the metaphysical. Besides affecting India's economy, political and social makeup and culture, it influenced the people's faith as well. These changes can be seen from the moment Farsi entered the culture to this day. It was with the help of Farsi that Islam managed to enter India and come to be known as a liberating faith alongside others.
There is definitely a connection because Islam came to India through channels. One of the most important and all-pervading channels has been the Persian channel. That is the people, the civilization which was created there with Iran as its center and whole Central Asia, part of that very civilization. Iran, when I talk of Iran in Persian, this is not the present geographical Iran. This is the Iran of Central Asia, because Central Asia was part of that Persian civilization. And Islam came to India largely through the channels which were created by the Persian Islamized civilization. So we had the people, the scholars, the saints, the scientists, all of them, they used Persian as a language of intellectual discourse as well as a language of the academic language. And there were Muslims ruling India for almost 800 years, and court language was Persian. Then again, Islam's main sources, primarily in Arabic. Then after Arabic, the most important work which was done in any other language is Persian, whether it is in Tafsirul Quran, whether it is the Sharah of Ahadith, whether it is Tasawwuf, whether it is Ilmul Kalam, or whether it is philosophy, and also even scientific works. We have scholars like Al-Biruni, who wrote in both, in Arabic language as well as in Persian language.
When I think about the connection between Farsi and India's history, I'm convinced that in order to understand that history, we must travel down the path of language, the Persian language. The language manuscripts and ancient texts are written in, the language poetry was versed in. Farsi, which embellishes ancient structures and was the means of communication between governments and the people down the ages, the language traders used to communicate in strange lands, the green treasure of India.